before, by the rivers of Babylon. There we sat down, yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hang our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof, for there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 24 through 27. Of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep. In journeying often, in peril of waters, in perils of robbers, in peril by mine own countrymen, in perils by heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watching often, in hunger and thirst, in fasting often, in cold and nakedness. I want to talk this evening for a few minutes from the subject, broken hopes and shattered dreams. Broken hopes and shattered dreams. On the eve of a new year, 1998, I wonder if you've ever experienced standing helplessly by and watched as one of your children or someone else drops some of your most expensive and cherished chinaware on the floor. As you stood there watching your dishes shattered into many pieces right before your eyes. If you have or haven't, life is sometimes like that. For some, if not for all. It presents us with broken hopes and shattered dreams. Life does. Sometimes we experience some of our fondest hopes and dearest dreams breaking and shattering just when we thought that they were about to come into reality. Allow me to underscore a list of examples of how one's hopes can be broken and one's dreams shattered. A young couple has been happily married for about 1 year. One day the wife comes home from the doctor's office and excitedly tells her husband, I'm pregnant. We are going to have a baby. They both, in a very enthusiastic way, share the joyous news. The husband begins to feel the level of his fatherly ego rising. Already he's getting ready to pass out whatever he wants to pass out. He begins to envision the arrival of his son or daughter. Then the day arrives when they are off to the hospital for the baby to be delivered. The doctors and nurses work eagerly in a very methodical way to deliver the baby. But something unfortunately goes wrong. The doctor walks from the delivery room to tell the would-be father, sir, your wife is fine, but I'm sorry to say that we lost the baby. A young man has dreamed since his elementary school days of becoming a professional football player. And after high school, he receives a football scholarship to a major college. This news excites him, and he begins to bubble over with great anticipation. His first year of college football goes well. He feels that his professional career is on track. But then one day during his third year, he tears some ligaments and some tissues in his knee. Over the summer, he undergoes surgery to correct the problem. Next season, he is back on the field to test himself. And after three games, he discovers that the knee will no longer take the punishment of the game. He feels the pain of all the hopes he has ever had on a professional football career dwindles right before his eyes. I'm talking about broken hopes now and shattered dreams. A man and woman have been married for over 25 years. The marriage has been a margin of success, an underscore margin of success. The children are now all out of school, and the husband says to himself, now is the time for my wife and I to enjoy ourselves, to enjoy each other, to enjoy life. He is all set for these new experiences. But not long thereafter, his wife says to him at the breakfast table, well, she says to him at Hardee's, forgot where I was for a minute. I thought I was down home in the country. She said to him, Bill, I have something serious to say. And he said, Bill, my life with you has not been happy. Now that the children are out of school, I want a divorce. A mother prays to God to be blessed with a son who will honor and glorify his name. In other words, she wants a boy who's going to be a preacher. And she takes note on the one of the children who just may be the one that for God to for ministry and to fulfill her dream. But the one who she thought was a gift from God for ministry ends up becoming one of the biggest drug dealers in Fayetteville. Y'all gonna pray with me? And he has no dealings with the church any kind of way. He doesn't show up unless one of his homies gets shot and they have to have a funeral. Help me, somebody. A pastor put forth a vibrant effort to lead the congregation as the Lord leads him. But there are many who will not follow regardless of what is going on. There are many who will just not follow. Some church-going person did his or her best to live peaceably with everybody in 97. But it hasn't worked out as of 11:45 on the last day of the year. What happened and what went wrong? These are broken hopes and shattered dreams. These persons looked at the pieces as they lay on the floor of their lives. If you have shared in experiences like these, I urge you tonight to take heart. For you are not alone. You have historical company. For the persons in our scripture text tonight, They also experience broken hopes, yes, sir, and shattered dreams. Yes, different people have different ways of dealing with their broken hopes and their shattered dreams. But when your hopes are broken and dreams are shattered. There are four ways I suggest that you deal with your situation. The first way to deal with your broken hopes and shattered dreams is to do as the Jews did in our text. Simply cry the blues. I said, cry the blues. They said of themselves, by the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and wept when we remembered how good it used to be. When we remember back home, we just sat down and we cried. 'Tis true that these Jewish people had been snatched from their homeland in Jerusalem and brought to Babylon by King Nebuchadnezzar to live in a state of semi-slavery. They so missed their homeland that they hung their harps on the Babylonian willow tree. And I tell you, my brothers and my sisters, regardless of what is going on around us, as children of God, we should never allow anything that cause us to not praise our God. Wherever we find ourselves. But like one psalmist, they each could say, my meat has been my tears both day and night. In the words of the singer Ray Charles, they drowned in their own tears. You remember that one before you start coming to watch tonight. You remember that. In truth, they experienced broken hopes and shattered dreams. But is crying an appropriate response to broken hope and shattered dreams? Of course not, for when we stop crying, the problem is still there. When we stop crying, the brokenness is still there. The second way to deal with broken hopes and shattered dreams is by becoming bitter and mean toward other folk. You know how that is. In the church, there are a lot of bitter and mean people. In the ministry, there are a lot of bitter and mean people. Some people allow their pent-up hurts and resentments to explode on others. Such persons release their anger on their children. Yes, on their husbands. On their wives. As well as on the general public. Did I mention the abuse church members perpetrate against their pastors? Help me, somebody. It's called pastor abuse. By that I mean members say anything, do anything, and refuse, a lot of folk refuse to even speak to the pastor. They ignore the pastor. They go around him to try and get things done. They try to one up on you, making you look bad. It's called pastor abuse. Help me, somebody. I saw an article in the newspaper not too long ago where this police officer turned bad. He decided that he was working for peanuts. He was not getting paid much for an unthankful job. And so he decided to join a stealing ring. And he was like a watch out man for those who were stealing in the neighborhood. And when he was finally arrested, he said, I got tired of kissing up to big people. I got tired of kissing up the other folk in the community. I have to spend nights watching somebody else's property while I don't have anything for myself. And I tell you, a lot of folk are like that. I say a lot of people are like that. He was resentful. Persons who are bitter and hurt want others to hurt. Just like they are hurting. Misery loves company. And it is rather miserable to be in the company of such bitter people. You say to them, good morning. And they say, what's so good about it? acting as if they awakened themselves last night. That they woke, they awakened themselves this morning. Not realizing that they could just as well have died in their sleep. So you can deal with your brokenness and your shatteredness by becoming more bitter and bitter. A third way to respond to broken hopes and shattered dreams is by becoming what psychologists call introverted. These persons, unlike the harbors of resentment, don't hurt others physically. They hurt themselves and others mentally. They do mental stuff on themselves and on you. They allow their hurts, their frustration and pain to be turned inward. They keep to themselves. They don't share their little worlds with anybody. They are detached from rest of society. They don't love and they don't hate. They don't laugh and they don't cry. They don't sing and they don't sigh. This describes some Christians who do nothing even in church. They are just here in the number. They're just on the road. This kind of response to broken hopes and shattered dreams can lead to all kinds of psychological disorders and maladjustment. But let me move to this fourth and final, the fourth and final way to face broken hopes and shattered dreams is to forthrightly and to deal with them forthrightly and squarely. We need to seek real help. I said we need to seek real help. We go to a lot of places looking for help. We go to our neighbors. We go see and I don't knock seeing the psychiatrists and the psychologists. I guess they can help some, but I like the fact that in our tradition we say that the Lord is a mind regulator. That He has always been our psychiatrist. Is the Lord all right? And so we need to go where some real help is. We should face our dilemmas and our problems armed with the Spirit of the Lord. And with an attitude of reliance on God. The Reverend Jesse Jackson once said that our attitude will determine our altitude. So one cannot rise in a higher than he can faint. As a man fainteth in his heart, so is he. The late Benjamin Mays, president of Morehouse College, said it must be borne in mind that the tragedy of life does not lie in not reaching your goal. The tragedy lies in having no goal to reach. It isn't a calamity to die with dreams unfulfilled, but it is a calamity to not to have a dream. It is not a disaster to be unable to capture your ideal, but it is a disaster to have no ideal to capture. So then he said, it is not a disgrace not to reach the stars, but it is a disgrace to have no stars to reach for. And he said, not failure, but low aim is sin. And my brothers and my sisters, as we celebrate here for Watch Night, we see in the New Testament scripture that Paul had to face his broken hopes and his shattered dreams. 2 Corinthians between chapter 11, verses 24 and 27 list the perils of his journey. And you remember that he left home a free man, but arrived in Rome as a prisoner of Caesar. But it didn't get him down. It didn't kill his spirit. It didn't break his resolve to be a servant of the Lord. He didn't cry the blues as some of the Jewish citizens did. He didn't become bitter and mean toward the people in Rome. He didn't become introverted and dry from within. Rather, Paul allowed the Spirit of Christ to refresh him daily. To refresh him daily. Lord, give us this day our daily bread. That is a refreshing. He had learned, as he later wrote to the church at Philippi, to be content with whatever state he was in. He learned that he could master all things through Christ who gave him strength. He could master any broken hope and any shattered dream. He kept things in right perspective. He kept his eye on the prize. In prison, he wrote all of the epistles. He could do it because he knew in whom he trusted. He knew he trusted in the Lord. And when he got down every once in a while, if he needed him a little song, no doubt he could sing just a little talk with Jesus. Makes everything all right. And every one of us in here tonight, when you get down and out, you ought to be able to whisper a little prayer. You ought to be able to sing a little song. You ought to be able to tell the Lord all about your condition. You remember Hezekiah? Hezekiah got sick. And he had a terminal illness that he didn't even know that he had. And when Isaiah showed up and told him that God said, God told me to tell you to get your house in order because you're going to die. And you remember what Hezekiah did? Hezekiah turned toward the wall and he said to God, evidently, you forgot who I am. I'm Hezekiah. And I serve you and I praise you. I'm faithful to you. And before the prophet could get out of the gate, God called him back. Said, go and tell Hezekiah that he got 15 more years. Is the Lord all right? In spite of all, the truth is, somebody here tonight, somebody came here tonight reflecting on 97, and they view it as a bust. That not a whole lot of good things happened to them. They heard other folk up testifying about what the Lord had done for them. And they say, I can't get up and say that because my 97 was a bust. Things been dismal all around me. They weren't just good. They just weren't good for me. They endure more pain than pleasure that they enjoy. And the last thing they need is a whitewash by a preacher. And I can sympathize with many of you tonight. And often I've sat where you sit. Broken and shattered, just like Hump the Dumpty. Amen. I've been broken and I've been shattered. I've been wounded. Talked about abuse, run down. Amen. All around me, problems are hard. Yes, I acknowledge problems are hard. The way does indeed seem dark. Your nights are long, but then because some things are wrong, you wonder why? Because you don't understand why the roads are so rough, broken up and shattered. Yes, but, and,
Yes. Yes. He's standing right near. God is right there to cheer you. I'm not trying to whitewash all you, but I want you to know that God is. If only you would let him. He's waiting to cheer you. Without a doubt, God will bring you out. So there is, I said there is hope in your shatteredness, in your brokenness. There is hope. Is there a witness? Is there a witness? Or in this house, somebody like Thomas, somebody need to see something. Some folk just can't believe unless they see something. And now somebody had a night. They need to meet somebody. They need to see somebody. That they know that the Lord. Somebody had a night. They need to see her right now, God. And if you won't be a witness, it's time to pray right now. I said, if you won't be a witness, I will. If you won't be a witness, help me somebody. 22 months ago, one of your members, Mount Olive, was one of my nurses. 22 months ago. Some of y'all came by 22 months ago down in Highsmith 22 months ago. Amen. A whole lot of folk gave up on God. They didn't give up on me, but they gave up on God. Word got out all over everywhere. They say, you know, Fuller's not going to get up. Help me somebody. Preachers were dusting off their resumes, getting ready to come to Lewis Chapel. Is the Lord all right? I said, if you won't be a witness, I'll be a witness. And I'll be a living witness. That I don't care how dark. I don't care how dark it is. And you've heard all kind of things. And but let me just say this, and I'm sitting. You know, I know that doctors can do a lot. And I thank God for doctors. And I thank them for all of their knowledge. Yes, I do tonight. But I believe in modern medicine in the hands of men and women who fear God. Is one of those things that Jesus had in mind when he said to his disciples that greater things you shall be able to do because I go to my Father. And you know, they say that if you have your colon taken out, that you're supposed to have a bag. They say you're supposed to have a bag. And they say if you don't have a bag, you got no control over your bodily function. They say all kind of things. Well, 22 months have passed. I don't have a colon. I don't have a bag. And I'm a witness tonight that if you let him, he will. He can. Now see, a lot of us just talk. A lot of this stuff we do in testimony ain't nothing but talk. We just talking. But then I understand something else. You can't have a testimony until you get one. And sometimes you have to go through. You have to have some broken hopes. and some shattered dreams so you can have a testimony. We serve. Say, we serve a great God. He can do anything but fail. He's a good God. He's a great God. Is there a witness? Is there a witness? Is there a witness? Yeah.